بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Methods of gaining space therapeutic extraction. This is, was supervised by Dr. Marwa Samih Shama and Dr. Shaza Hamad and prepared by Iqdal Ahmed and Shaima Saad. These are the references: textbook for orthodontics, contemporary handbook for orthodontics, and art and science. The contents or methods of gaining space, therapeutic extraction, the historical background, the need for extraction, different extraction procedures, choice of teeth for extraction, extraction versus expansion. Methods of gaining space in orthodontics are proximal stripping, arch expansion, distalization of molars, uprighting of tilted teeth, derotation of posterior teeth, proclination of anterior teeth, and extraction. Therapeutic extraction can be defined as a painless removal of teeth from its socket. It's one of the most common methods for gaining space in the arch. The historical background. John Hunter recognized the role for extraction in orthodontics in his book Natural History of the Teeth. Engel advocated expansion as it improved the function of the masticatory apparatus and what resulted in loss of the jaw, creating adequate space for the dentition. But Calvin Casey's former student contended that teeth may be extracted occasionally to produce lasting results. This led to the great extraction controversy in 1920s between the two schools of thought. By the late 1940s, extraction was reintroduced by Charles Tweed as it was found to be more stable. By the early 1960s, more than half of orthodontic patients had extractions of some teeth as part of their orthodontic treatment. Extraction versus expansion. Orthodontists have debated the limits of expansion for the dental arches, whether the advantages of extraction of some teeth to provide space. With extraction, the loss of tooth or teeth is disadvantage. Greater stability and supporting tissue health are likely and are an advantage, and there may be positive or negative effects on facial aesthetics. The majority of orthodontic patients can and should be treated without removal of teeth, but some will require extraction to compensate for crowding and or incisor protrusion that affects facial aesthetics. For others, extraction to camouflage a jaw discrepancy will be needed. So, the key factors are facial and dental aesthetics, post-treatment stability, and dental occlusion. So, for aesthetics, if you have full lips, then you can choose extraction, not expansion. For the stability, if you want more stable results, then you can go for extraction. Aesthetic illustrations, aesthetic considerations. Expansion of the arch moves the patient in the direction of more prominent teeth, but extraction tend to reduce the prominence of the teeth. Facial aesthetics can become unaccepted on either the too protrusive or too retrusive side. This depends on soft tissue, not hard tissue relationships. Here, when the prominence of the incisors creates excessive lip separation at rest, so the patient must strain to bring his lips together. The teeth are too protrusive, and retracting incisors in this case improves the facial appearance. The size of the nose and the chin affects lip prominence. When a large nose or large chin to treat without extraction and moves the incisor forward is better than extraction, provided it does not separate the lips too much. for stability considerations. Extraction has the advantage of paying more stable. For more stable result in concentrations of extraction versus expansion, two size arch width discrepancy can be measured by Pons index, Linderhardt index, Ashley House index. These indexes are explained in the CAST analysis lecture. The need for extraction. We go for extraction in case of arch length to material discrepancy, correction of sagittal inter-arch relationship, and extraction for the relief of crowding. For arch length to material discrepancy, it's not normally accepted to increase the dental arch size because the increased dental arch dimensions will not be tolerated by the oral musculature. The guidelines for extraction in class 1 crowding protrusion less than 4 mm, then extraction is rarely indicated. 5 to 9 mm, so non-extraction or extraction is possible, depends on the details of the therapy. More than 10 mm extraction almost always required. Correction of sagittal inter-arch relationship. In class 1 malocclusion, extracting both arches because it's not advisable to discourage the development of only one arch more than the other. In most class 2 cases with abnormal upper proclination, normal alignment of the lower teeth, and where A point is abnormally forward relative to B point, it's advisable to extract teeth only in the upper arch. When the lower arch is crowded or molars are not in full cast, class 2 molar relationship, then extract in both arches. In class 3 cases, usually treated by extraction by extracting teeth only in the lower arch. Extraction for the relief of crowding. Extraction for relief of crowding will be governed by the condition of the tooth, the position of the crowding, and the position of the teeth. So, when we have fractured or hypoplastic, grossly carious teeth, root canal treated teeth, and teeth with large restorations are preferred for extraction over healthy teeth. Position of crowding. Crowding in one part of the arch is more readily corrected if extractions are done in the area of crowding. However, incisor crowding is usually relieved by premolar extraction as it gives a more pleasing appearance and occlusal balance with the incisor extraction. Then, the first premolar positioned in the center of each quadrant is usually near the area of crowding, whether in the anterior or buccal segment, hence also the tooth most frequently extracted along with orthodontic treatment. Grossly malpositioned teeth which are difficult to align may often be the teeth of choice for extraction. The position of the apex of the tooth must be considered as it's more difficult to move the apex of the crown. Here are some terms about different extraction procedures: balanced extraction, compensating extractions, serial extractions, enforced extractions, Wilkinson extractions, and therapeutic extraction. Balancing extractions. If a tooth is removed from one side of the dental arch, so tendency for the remaining teeth to move toward the extraction space leads to asymmetry, so it's usual to balance extraction in order to prevent such symmetry. So balancing extraction can be defined as the removal of a tooth in the opposite side of the same arch in order to preserve symmetry. Compensating extraction. Removal of the equivalent tooth in the opposing arch to maintain buccal occlusion. In some class 1 crowding cases, it's necessary to extract in both arches to maintain the lateral symmetry. Compensating extractions preserve inter-arch relationship by allowing the posterior teeth to drift forward together. Serial extractions. It's an interceptive orthodontic procedure usually initiated in the early maxillary dentition when one can recognize potential irregularities in the dentofacial complex and is corrected by a procedure that includes the planned extraction of certain deciduous teeth and later specific permanent teeth in an orderly sequence and a predetermined pattern to early manifestation of tooth size and length discrepancy. Guides the erupting permanent teeth into a more favorable position. Enforced extractions. It's carried out because they are necessary, as in the case of grossly decayed tooth, poor periodontal status, fractured tooth, impacted tooth, etc. Wilkinson extraction. Wilkinson advocated extraction of all four first permanent molars between the age of 8.5 and 9 years. The basis for such extractions is the fact that the first molars are highly susceptible to caries. The other benefits of extracting first molars at an early age are to avoid third molar impaction by providing additional space for their eruption and to reduce the crowding in the arch. They have various drawbacks. They provide limited space for crowding, and the adjacent teeth step into the extraction space. The periodontal is the principal anchor unit for orthodontic appliances lost. Therapeutic extraction. These are extractions carried out for the purpose of treatment. The choice of teeth for extraction depends on the direction and amount of jaw growth, discrepancy between size of dental arches and basal arches, state of soundness, position and eruption of teeth, facial profile, degree of dento-alveolar prognathism, age of the patient, state of dentition as a whole. Maxillary incisors. They are rarely extracted as a part of orthodontic therapy, but the indications may be unfavorably impacted maxillary incisors, grossly carious incisors, trauma, irreparable damage to the incisor by fracture, buccally or lingually blocked out lateral incisor with good contact between centrals and canines. If a lateral incisor is crowded in lingual occlusion with its apex palatally displaced, and if the canine is erupting in a forward position and is upright or distally inclined, lateral incisor extraction is indicated. Mandibular incisors. Also, their extraction should be avoided as far as possible because it causes retroclination of lower incisors, remaining anterior teeth to imbricate. Although crowding may be relieved in the short term, forward movement of buccal teeth leaves the incisors' contacts less than ideal. Lower intercanine width decreases, resulting in a secondary reduction in the upper intercanine width with crowding in the upper labial segment. Causes deep bite. It's not possible to fit four upper incisors around the three lower incisors either. An increase in overjet or upper incisor crowding have to be accepted. However, extraction of lower incisors may be appropriate in such cases. When one incisor is completely excluded from the arch and there are satisfactory approximal contact between other incisors. When there is poor prognosis, as in case of trauma, caries, bone loss, severely malpositioned incisors, lower canines are severely inclined distally and lower incisors are faint, it's very difficult to correct this condition by extractions further back in the arch. The most upright incisor is selected for extraction and so that the teeth can be tapped into correct position. In mind, class 3 incisor relation with an acceptable upper arch and lower incisor crowding, lower incisor may be extracted to achieve normal overjet, overbite, and to relieve crowding. Poulton's mandibular anterior excess more than 4 mm. Contraindications for mandibular incisor extraction. In cases of deep bite with horizontal cross pattern, all cases which require upper first premolar extraction while canines are in class 1 relationship, bimaxillary crowding cases with no tooth size discrepancy in the incisor area, cases having anterior discrepancy due to either small incisors or large upper incisors. Canines. The permanent canines are important teeth and are not frequently extracted as a part of orthodontic treatment. Their extraction causes flattening of the face, altered facial balance, and change in facial expressions. When the lower canine is crowded, it's sometimes tempting to extract this tooth. However, this is avoided because the proximal contact between lateral incisor and the first premolar is rarely satisfactory. So the indications for canine extraction for the mandibular canine may be extracted when it's likely to be very difficult to align as when it's excluded from the arch and the apex is severely malpositioned or when it's unfavorably impacted. For the upper canines, they are commonly impacted or ectopic and their alignment is difficult or even impossible. This is because they develop far away from the final location and have a long path of eruption. Therefore, they can be extracted when completely excluded from the arch and the proximal contact between lateral incisor and first premolar is good. Extraction of first premolars. It's the tooth most commonly extracted as part of orthodontic therapy, especially for the relief of crowding because it's positioned near the center of each quadrant of the arch and is therefore near the site of crowding. First premolar extraction is the least likely to upset molar occlusion and is the best alternative to maintain vertical dimension. The contact between the canine and second premolar is satisfactory. Final first premolar extraction leaves behind a posterior segment that offers adequate anchorage for retention for retraction of the 6 anterior teeth. Indications. We said it's a tooth of choice to extract to relieve moderate to severe anterior crowding in both arches. Correction of moderate to severe anterior preclination as in class 2 division 1 or class 1 bimaxillary protrusion. In high anchorage cases of the first premolar takes precedence over second premolar to be extracted. As a part of serial extraction. Timing for extraction. The first premolars should not be extracted until all premolars, permanent incisors, and canines have erupted sufficiently for brackets to be placed on them, as mesial migration is greatly increased by extraction. The only exception to this rule is when second the premolars cannot erupt because they are impacted. The four first premolars should not be extracted more than 3 weeks before starting active treatment, to avoid mesial migration of posterior teeth, leaving insufficient space for retraction. Extraction of second premolars. The indications, when completely excluded from the arch following forward drift or first molar after early loss of deciduous second molar, unfavorably impacted second premolars, grossly carious or periodontally compromised, second premolar extraction is preferred in mild anterior crowding cases, second premolar extraction is preferred when the need of soft tissue profile and aesthetics in open bite cases encourages deepening of the bite. Extraction of first molar. Deemed as untouchable from the very beginning of the history of orthodontics, it is a cornerstone of the dentition. It has been the subject of considerable debate as to its value in the dental arch, as it has been the most susceptible permanent tooth in childhood. Said it that it should never be removed. Alternately, it has been advocated that it can be removed as a routine measure with benefit to dental arches. So, there is no single rule can be made which fits every individual. The extraction of first molar is avoided because it does not give adequate space to relieve anterior crowding, and it causes deepening of the bite and poor proximal contact between second premolar and second molar. The second premolar and second molar may tip into the extraction space and the mastication is affected. However, the indications can be: minimum space requirement for correction of anterior crowding or mild proclination, grossly decayed periodontally compromised molar with poor prognosis, or impacted molar, which is rarely seen. The best time for extraction of first permanent molar: when crowding is absent or confined to the premolar segment and no space is needed for anterior alignment, then first molar is removed before second molar erupts to allow it to move forward during eruption and take up the first molar position. Also, lower first molar needs to be removed earlier than the upper first molar because the second molar moves forward less readily in the lower jaw. When space is required for alignment of anterior teeth, it's preferable to wait for second molar eruption before the first molar extraction to avoid space closure by forward movement of the second molar. If fixed appliances are used skillfully, most problems caused by enforced first molar extractions can be overcome. However, treatment lasts somewhat longer than with first premolar extraction. Here are the national clinical guidelines for extraction of first permanent molars in children. The ideal timing of first permanent molar extraction: an upper arch and an erupted upper 7 will generally achieve a good occlusal position following extraction of the first permanent molar. However, in the lower arch, occlusal outcome can be more variable and less predictable. So, the timing of the first molar extraction in the lower arch is more important for successful eruption of the second permanent molar. The most favorable chronological age range is 8 to 10 years after eruption of the lateral incisor spot, before the eruption of second molar and or second premolar. Analysis of second premolar development as a predictor for successful eruption suggests that radiographic evidence of calcification within the root bifurcation produces the best occlusal position. The response of the 7 is variable, and acceptable positions are also possible in association with extraction at earlier or later stages of 7 development. Favorable mesial movement of mandibular second permanent molar seems to be most predictable if radiographs show they are still within a bone at the time of extraction of the first permanent molar. The age of 8, there is often no radiographic evidence of third molar development. In addition, in the lower arch, the second premolar can drift distally into the extraction space, tip or rotate. The labial segments can decline with an accompanying increase in the overjet, in the overbite. So, what about spontaneous space closure after the extraction of first permanent molars? The evaluation of a spontaneous space closure after extraction of first permanent molars. In this research, 236 second permanent molars from 63 patients were clinically assessed. The position of each 7 was recorded in relation to the 5 against 7 radiographic development stage at the time of 6 extraction. Only 54% of the 7s were at the ideal stage of development at the time of 6 extraction, and 92% of all upper extractions resulting in complete space closure regardless of the 7 development stage, and only 66% of the lower sexes extracted at 7's ideal stage of development had complete space closure. So, it was concluded that although only over half of the patients had sexes extracted at the ideal time, this did not appear to influence successful positioning of the upper or lower 7. So what are the consequences of early extraction of compromised first permanent molar? In this systematic review, this study aimed to systematically review the literature to determine the sequence of early extraction of compromised first permanent molars with regard to the skeletal and dental development of 5 to 15-year-old child. The consequences were: decrease in post-extraction space, accelerated development and eruption of 7 and 8, a decrease in caries or phalanx on the proximal surface of adjacent teeth, lingual tapping and retrusion of incisors, counterclockwise rotation of the occlusal plane. So, this systematic review suggests that comprehensive evaluation of the compromised first permanent molars should be performed before planning an extraction. The ideal time for its extraction is when the second permanent molar is at the early bifurcation stage in order to achieve complete closure of the extraction space by the second molar. Benefits should be weighed over the risks to decrease the risk of unfavorable outcomes as much as possible. Extraction of second molar. Mandibular second molar is positioned at the end of the dental arch away from the site of crowding, so its extraction does not help in relieving the crowding and may be indicated in: to relieve impaction of second premolars when forward drift to the first permanent molar following premature loss of the second deciduous molars causes insufficient space for second premolar eruption, second molar extraction allows distal movement of the first permanent molar. This provides enough space for premolar eruption. To relieve lower incisor crowding, minimum lower incisor alignment might be seen, but this effect is usually transient. To prevent lower incisor crowding, evidence shows that patients with lower second molar extraction suffered less lower arch shortening. To correct mild or moderate arch length deficiencies existing with good facial profiles, severely carious or ectopically erupted 7, or severely rotated open bite cases, extraction may help in the correction of anterior open bite. To relieve impaction of mandibular third molar, conditions where lower 7 can result in reasonable third molar position R. When a third molar is upright or its long axis is not tilted mesially more than 30 degrees to the long axis of the second molar. When the second molar is extracted only after calcification of the third molar crown or just after root formation of the third molar has started, usually between 12 and 14 years. Extraction of maxillary second molar. Indications. In mildly crowded cases where less than 3 to 4 mm space is required for the labial segments, to make a space for crowded second premolar by distalization of first molar. When second molar is impacted against the first molar, second molar extraction is preferred over extraction of severely impacted third molar for which there is no space in the line of the occlusion. Criteria for maxillary second molar extraction are and replacement by third molar. The chronologic and dental age of the patient should be past the average time when second molars would erupt. Size and shape and root area of the third molar should be sufficient to serve in place of second molar. Maxillary tuberosity should be insufficient to accommodate all three molars. If second molar is in buccal occlusion and the third molar is positioned in the tuberosity, maxillary third molar is in favorable angulation for eruption. Second molar is severely carious with questionable prognosis. Contraindications for upper second molar extraction. When maxillary third molars are positioned high in the tuberosity, poor angulation in relation to second molar, undersized crown or roots, third molar butt is absent. Timing of extraction. Mandibular second molar should be extracted as soon as it erupts, provided that the third molar crown is complete and before its roots begin to develop. Maxillary second molar should be extracted when the third molar has migrated sufficiently in the alveolar bone, so that the occlusal surface is approximately level with the vertical midline of the second molar root. The advantages of second molar extraction. It facilitates treatment using removable appliances, eruption of third molar is faster, prevention of dish thin appearance of the face, few residual spaces at the end of the treatment, good mandibular arch form, less chances of relapse, increases over bite, hence in open bite cases. The disadvantages are too much two substances removed in mild crowding cases. Extraction site away from the area of crowding. It's not certain that third molars will erupt even after second molar extraction. Final third molar position may be unacceptable. Increases over bite. Third molar extraction. Extraction of third molar during orthodontic treatment does not yield space for decrowding or reduction of proclination. But the indications can be impacted third molar. The conventional timing of extraction of it is when 2/3 of its root is formed. Extraction of it should not be delayed because it's more difficult to remove when roots are completed. Danger of root dilaceration, which may make removal difficult. Pericornitis can develop and can cause bone loss and pocket formation may occur distal to the second molar. Second indication, erupting mandibular third molars have been implicated to be the cause of late anterior crowding, although the evidence is not clear. Cut. In adolescence and early adult life, progressive crowding of anterior teeth is commonly seen. Late crowding develops around the eruption time of third molars, which many dentists feel due to the pressure from third molar. However, it's difficult to detect such a force. In fact, late anterior crowding often develops in individuals whose lower third molars are congenitally missing. Malformed third molars which interfere with the normal occlusion should be removed. Thank you for your listening.